My name is Myron McCoy, and I serve as senior pastor here at the First United Methodist Church at the Chicago Temple, and it is my joy to welcome you to worship. Before I begin, I want to share several quick announcements. We continue to celebrate Women's History Month, and you may want to take advantage of different opportunities around the city. Today's special offering is for UMCOR. UMCOR is our United Methodist Committee on Relief. The offering today will help to underwrite administrative costs for that ministry of our general church. I want to remind you of the Bible study. It ends this coming Tuesday with study at 12 noon and 6:30 p.m. They're looking at the Gospel of Mark. It's taught by Reverend Tora Foster Gillespie and Reverend Dr. Shel Magrini. Our Lenten Bible study continues on Saturdays from 3:30 to 4:45 during Lent. You may join us. The leaders are Pastor Sophia and myself. You're reminded of the virtual spring book study. And that's every Monday night from 6 p.m. to 7 p.m., The Politics of Jesus. You may want to purchase that book and begin reading for that. I also want to make you aware of the Bridge Builders Book Club. The next Bridge Builders Book Club will be in May, and the title of the book is Outside the Lines. And you may want to pick up that book as well to join us. This is a book study where we're seeking to have people look at differences and how we might begin to better understand one another. There's a special survey, First United Methodist Church Phoenix Survey, we're calling it, Rising from the Ashes of the Pandemic. Be on the watch this coming week for a special email to First United Methodist Church members and regular worshipers next week that will introduce and include an important survey being broadly conducted by us. And this will ascertain our ability to make needed adaptations for future ministry as we seek to rebuild the congregation post-pandemic. When you get that survey, please fill it out. It is important that we hear from you so that we can make important decisions. All of these activities are detailed in the Tuesday and Friday e-carillons. Let's enjoy our time of worship together.
Thank you, Reverend McCoy, for sharing with us those announcements. And now let's look at today's service. We'll start off with our prayer of confession and pardon, which will be led by Reverend Sophia Hyon. We'll start out with the prayer of confession, which all are asked to participate in, followed by a moment of silence, and then the prayer of pardon. We have a couple hymns today. First, from The Faith We Sing, number 2162, Grace Alone. Hymn number 581, Lord, Whose Love Through Humble Service. And our offertory anthem today is Amazing Grace by Anthony Furnival. Our scripture reading for today is from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 to 10, and that'll be read by Mike Wilkerson. Our sermon today is entitled All by Grace and will be delivered by Reverend Dr. Sherry Magrini. Also, our offertory message today is on the church and will be given to us by one of our members, Christine Usman. And lastly, the prayers of the people will be led today by Reverend Dr. Myron McCoy. So again, thank you for joining us, and now I ask that we all silent our hearts and minds and center them upon God as Reverend Sophia leads us in today's prayer of confession and pardon. Let us pray.
Merciful God, we confess that in our turning towards what is destructive to humanity and creation, we are separated from you. The dark covering of night hides our sin. Through the agonizing suffering of your Son, we plead that we would receive forgiving grace. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. The Mighty One has sent His deliverance for all people, even the generations yet unborn. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Amen.
Our scripture reading today is from the letter to the Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 4 through 10. God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. May God add a blessing to the reading and hearing of God's word.
Thank you so much to all our musicians this morning. Haven't we just been so blessed with our section leaders, strings, Kelly singing Bridge Over Troubled Waters and the handbells. So thank you to all the musicians for this blessing this morning in our worship. Would you join me in prayer? And the opening prayer actually is one that you hear often from preachers at the beginning of the sermons. So this is actually taken from Psalm 19. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Having arrived at this fourth Sunday of Lent, each of us is charting our own progress in terms of thought and deeper reflective prayer. Lenten spiritual growth is like daily walking labyrinth circuits that lead to the quiet center, pausing to enter into prayer. Then the labyrinth circuits lead you from this calming center back into the rhythm of your daily life. You are sent out being grounded in the encompassing love of God with you in whatever you encountered that day. This Ephesians passage is one of the most familiar and beloved in the entire Pauline collection of letters. They are among the most beautiful words written in the epistles. These words convey the essence, the centering message of the gospel. But God, who is rich in mercy out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. So I want to ask you, first off, what does the word grace convey in our everyday language? We might say a dancer is graceful. Person walks across the room with grace. A painting graces the room with its style. And we ask at meals, whose turn is it to say grace? And we often pray, most merciful and gracious God. Now, the letters of Paul nearly all begin with a salutation that includes a greeting of grace. To the saints who are in Ephesus, or it could be Galatia, Philippi, and are faithful in Christ Jesus, grace to you and peace from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, later in Ephesians, we have in chapter 4, verse 7, but each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. And then in chapter 6, verse 24, grace be with all who have an undying love for our Lord Jesus Christ. Saved by grace through faith. If anyone, it was the Apostle Paul, once the epitome of persecuting early Christian believers, who understood what salvation by grace means. He preached that being saved by grace through faith, not by how often or how many good works a person does, leads a person to the forgiving grace of Jesus Christ. And faith itself is a gift from God. We live in a world where a person is expected to earn their keep and prove their merit. Now, can you expel a sigh of relief? Can you let go of trying to be good enough and measure up and wondering if you have enough faith, pray hard enough, and that if you are on enough church committees, God would make everything turn out all right? God's great mercy triumphs over judgment and gives us kindness and hope that we could never earn. Grace is given at great price in the suffering and ultimately the death of Christ. God's redeeming grace rises into our hearts through the resurrection of Christ that we look to in the coming weeks because we are on this side of the cross. Imagine this. On a day when you have been particularly sad, grieving, searching, or wandering in the wilderness by turning away from God, you hear a knock on the door and you say to yourself, I'm not expecting anyone. I did not order takeout or expecting a FedEx package. Still, you open the door and see someone holding out a gift box. It is wrapped in the most beautiful packaging you have ever seen. Your name is on the gift tag with perfect lettering. To find out what is in the box, you need to take it into your hands and open the gift. When you look inside, you are filled with a sense of peace, of God's embracing love and hope. There is a way forward that you could never have imagined. When you receive a gift, what is your response? Hopefully, young children, right from the start, are taught to say thank you for a gift. I received a drawing thank you note from my 4-year-old nephew from his Christmas gift. Thank yous get sent by text and email, over virtual calls, over the phone, and even better in the months to come, hopefully with a hug in person and a thank you in person. Grace is like glimpsing the moon between two high rises. Grace is like seeing a double rainbow over Lake Michigan. Grace is also like finding a soul friend with whom you can lament working long hours that leave children alone at home. Grace is like a community center that provides meals and programming for seniors. Grace is like a hospital worker who cares about the grieving family. In gratitude for this ultimate gift of grace, we act for and with family, friends, and the community in ways that lead to healing, kindness, and compassion. We are to do this with hearts of joy, even when it is difficult. This means giving up chasing after the best car, being realistic instead of taking on a mortgage beyond what you can afford, and giving up taking expensive vacations when a family waits for a visit. Gratitude means being a servant rather than expecting to be served. We bear upon our faces the light of Christ that overcomes hopelessness, creates friendship in place of loneliness, and relieves overwhelming worry that wears us down. We respond to the suffering, death, and resurrection of Christ with gratitude for the new life we are given with Christ. Paul wrote in Romans chapter 6, verse 4, and this is a verse I think so many of us are familiar with from baptisms. Therefore, we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. Newness of life. I want to share with you this morning hymns about grace that touch my spirit deeply and show me how to live every day in the hand of God's grace. Music, we know, has the capacity to bring scripture into one's very heart, soaring to the feet of Jesus, joining with the angelic choir, praising God. I think you will find that one of these hymns is a favorite of yours too. Then I'm going to share with you about two women in my family line of different generations whose lives embody serving God in good works in gratitude for God's grace. Come Thy Fount of Every Blessing is one of my favorite hymns. The lyrics were written by Robert Robinson and the tune by Ashiel Nettleton in 1758. Robert was, as a parent says, a handful. At the age of 20, after hearing George Whitefield preach, Robert turned to faith and wrote this hymn. He eventually became a Methodist preacher, then a Baptist, and finally a Unitarian. These words are from stanza one. Come, Thy Fount of Every Blessing, tune my heart to sing Thy grace. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of Thy redeeming love. Now, another hymn that is a favorite of mine, and I know this has got to be a favorite of all of you, but Grace might not necessarily come to mind right away. It's Silent Night. In 1818, Joseph Moore, in a village near Salzburg, Austria, wrote Silent Night upon finding the church organ broken and his group could not perform. The church organist, Franz Gruber, wrote the tune and they performed it with guitar on Christmas morning. This is in stanza three. Silent night, holy night, Son of God, love's pure light, radiant beams from Thy holy face with the dawn of redeeming grace. Jesus, Lord, at Thy birth, Jesus, Lord, at Thy birth. The advent of God into humanity surely has come with the dawn of redeeming grace. Now, two hymns that I cannot leave off my list of favorites about grace are And Can It Be That I Should Gain by Charles Wesley, and then Amazing Grace by John Newton. Now, the first, I think, is probably not as familiar to you as Amazing Grace. On the evening of May 24th, 1738, that of John Wesley's personal salvation experience at Aldersgate, he wrote in his journal, I felt I did trust in Christ, Christ alone for salvation. And Can It Be That I Should Gain is believed to be one of the hymns they sang that night. Charles Wesley published the hymn in 1739 under the title of Free Grace. Now, should you want to dive into John Wesley's working out what salvation by grace means for him, read his sermon, The Scripture Way of Salvation. This is the culmination of his earlier writings on grace and salvation. And it's written about verse 8 from Ephesians that we had today. You are saved by grace through faith. I'm going to tell you a little story about this hymn and why it's one of my favorites. I first heard And Can It Be That I Should Gain years ago while arriving in Kingston, Jamaica with a group of United Methodists on a mission trip. We were there to build the foundation of a new community center in the mountain village of Cambridge. Leaving the airport, four of us fit closely into a very small car in the heat. Our driver weaved around cars on a quite narrow road going up the mountain at fast speed. And he sang this hymn the entire ride. All I was doing was just praying that we would get to the mission site without being in a car accident on the mountain road. He ended up being a dear friend on this trip, and we sang this hymn often. Now, Amazing Grace, even if a person is not of the Christian faith, most people would know Amazing Grace and have sung it in their own language around the world. The hymn was written by English clergyman John Newton, who participated in the slave trade, transporting enslaved Africans to North America before his conversion in 1748. He was ordained an Anglican minister in 1764, and 8 years later, he wrote Amazing Grace and then first published it in 1779. You probably recall one of the most public singing of Amazing Grace. 6 years ago, while attending Bible study, 9 people were shot dead in Charleston, South Carolina. It was a racially motivated shooting targeting the historic Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church. President Obama gave the eulogy at the memorial service for this pastor and South Carolina State Senator, Reverend Clementa Pinckney. At the conclusion of his speaking, he began a solo of Amazing Grace, and soon the entire congregation was singing along with him. He actually had not made up his mind if he would sing the hymn until he stood up at the podium. Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. These are words that heal, words of hope, words of life transformed. A more contemporary hymn, a favorite of mine, is Grace Alone by Scott Wesley Brown that we've already sung this morning in our worship. I like this so much because the lyrics describe what it means to be a disciple, how we are to bring the grace of God into times of despair and sorrow. And the hymn ends like this. Every loving word we say, every tear we wipe away, every sorrow turned to praise is only by his grace. We will go forth in grace alone. This hymn brings me to the second part of the Ephesians passage. I want to talk about what it means to do good works out of gratitude for the gift of grace. Lives that turn to living out the grace of God is the response of faithful Christians. We know what this looks like through following the path that Jesus led the crowds, the disciples of men and women, and the Jews and Gentiles. You've probably heard on the news just this week, the cost of life in doing good works was emotionally portrayed across the world in the image of Sister Anne Rose Newtong in Myanmar, kneeling in front of riot police. She begged them to stop killing protesters demonstrating against last month's military coup. While she knelt on the ground in front of the military police, she said, "Shoot me instead." Soon after, 2 protesters were fatally shot and many others injured. She was blinded by tear gas as she tried to move the injured to her nearby clinic. Doing good is not always an easy path. There are 2 women in my family whose lives show in quite different ways what it means to do good out of gratitude. My maternal grandmother, my Grandma Travis, was a woman of faith. And her faith kept her going throughout her 97 years. She was born in 1907 and passed on to her eternal home in 2004. She lived through World War I and II and the Great Depression, during which she raised 6 children. I asked my mother how Grandma Travis came to be a woman of such deep faith. And my mother said, quote, "Even though there were many difficult times, she always encouraged us to go to Sunday school and church. She quietly instilled her faith in God to us and never wavered in desperate times. She was a non-judgmental person. She quietly used her faith in everything she did. As my siblings and I grew into adults, we all realized how strong her faith was and how she had gotten through her journey of life. It is so important that we teach our children about faith. end quote. In her later years, Grandma always had her Bible next to her favorite chair. Even when her sight was going, she went to the weekly Bible study in the senior community where she lived. I remember her being active in the small town Methodist church and in the United Methodist Women's Group, and she was so well loved in that church. So fast forward three generations to the youngest woman in my family tree. My 28-year-old niece, Becca, is a licensed clinical social worker in Minneapolis, Minnesota. Becca is a woman of Christian faith and humility. She is deeply committed to living as Jesus showed us, as a way of saying thank you to God for all that God has given her. I asked her in a text, of course, if I could talk about her in this sermon this morning. And I sent her the Ephesians passage, again in a text, and she replied that this passage is one she has read many, many times. She works for the Christian nonprofit organization in Minneapolis called ACE in the City. The organization provides for the needs of low-income Latinx families, many with Spanish-speaking only parents. She shares the gospel through children and youth programming, helping with their schooling and helping parents navigate school, city, and immigrant issues. The bilingual staff live in the neighborhoods they serve. She now has a nonprofit that expands the neighborhood and home support with these families. So here are the thoughts that Becca sent me. Quote, I've read this Ephesians passage many times. I focus now on the last part of the message. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Jesus prayed, but he also took action. I try to live by pray with your hands. I have never felt closer to Yahweh and Jesus than when I am sitting with a family speaking Spanish and helping with their homework, or when I am teaching teenagers how to drive because parents have to work, or when I am crying with friends over the hurt and heartache of their oppression in today's systems. I think that is why he says we are created to do good works. We were created to live that way. This has caused me to look at temptation, like desiring comfort over community, materials over memories, what society tells me to have versus what is kingdom-minded. This has led me to what I am doing now. These beautiful relationships have given me way more than I've given them, end quote. I think it's just quite something that Becca has this sense of who she is in Christ and how she is to follow this path that God has laid out before her. The reflection questions I would like to leave you with are, how can you live in gratitude for the gift of God's grace? In these Lenten steps towards the cross, what does it mean for you to stop along the way to bring persons into the wholeness of community and to be compassionate? How can you be merciful as God has shown you mercy? Some 300 years ago, John Wesley said, and this is probably familiar to so many of you, do all the good you can by all the means you can, in all the ways you can, in all the places you can, at all the times you can, to all the people you can, as long as ever you can. And closing with this verse from Ephesians that we had this morning. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Good morning, Church. My name is Christine Usman. I've been attending the Chicago Temple since 2006. You might recognize me from Temple Strings or sitting with my kids in the Mabuhay space. Like several others in this congregation, I am a PK or pastor's kid. So I can't ever remember a time when the church hasn't been a major part of my life. My siblings and I attended every event and were often drafted to serve as last-minute ushers, acolytes, or to fold bulletins. When I left home for college, it was a sudden change for me. I wasn't the PK anymore, not someone that everybody knew by association with the pastor. Finding a church home meant finding one for myself, and I was attracted to this church because it reminded me of the church I grew up in. The organ music, the United Methodist hymns, the sermons grounded in scripture were all things that were familiar and comforting. After seeing Temple Strings on the Sunday schedule in the bulletin, I was eager to join. It gave me a way to meet new people and give an offering of music while having the added benefit of being fun. 15 years later, I still play with the strings, and I've become close friends with this group of musicians. Everything changed for me in 2014 when I became a parent. I started to look at the world through the lens of how I wanted my children to grow in it, and I knew for sure that I wanted them to have God in their lives. Sunday started taking on a new routine. With a violin case backpack and a stroller with Layla and Errol in tow, we would attend 8:30 service, then the kids would go to Sunday school at 9:45 while I rehearsed with the strings. And at 10:30 when rehearsal ended, I would pop in late to the parent Sunday school class until the kids were finished with theirs. As I watched my children build their community of friends in Sunday school and learn about God's wonderful works through stories, I see my own faith in God growing through my expanding interactions with the nursery, Sunday school teachers, and other parents. Being a member of the Chicago Temple has helped me grow in my faith because it has evolved and changed with me. It gave me opportunities to serve through music and then later welcomed my children into the fellowship of God. This is just my story, but there are many others like it. If you've ever attended Homecoming Sunday, there are countless other programs to get involved in, such as Bible studies, the Fine Arts Committee, and the Stevens Ministry. All these are potential avenues to support you in your faith journey. Now it's March 2021, and we've been in a pandemic for about a year. This is a time that we rely on our faith in God to give us the strength to get through these trying times and lean on our church community for the support we need, whether it's mourning or just being around caring people. I've been amazed and impressed that even though we aren't worshiping together in person, my church community has remained steadfast. I see God's love at work through the Zoom worship services every Sunday, which still gives me that weekly recharge. The Temple Strings are still playing together, occasionally in person, so we can still participate in service. And I'm happy to say that my kids can still enjoy a Sunday school of sorts. Every Sunday, Pierce posts a children's message with a story and a song on the YouTube channel, and we've been lucky to join Brenna's periodic music Zoom classes. I encourage you to explore how the Chicago Temple can help you grow in your faith, however it may change and evolve.
Saved a wretch like me.
invite you to pray with me. Eternal God, we bow this day on our Lenten journey. We are very aware of our need to retool our souls, and like the people of ancient days, we find ourselves struggling with the same issues in which they struggle. Like them, we are edgy and impatient. We want things to go our way, and we want them to do so immediately. How often we fail to see the slow and small ways in which you provide for our growth. Like the ancients, we too recognize ourselves as grumbling, complaining people living in a negative culture. Oh Lord, it's so easy to complain. It's easy to be negative. Forgive us for often taking this simple, undemanding road. Help us to look upon life as good. Help us in hard times to see our glasses in life as half full rather than as half empty. Help us to rejoice as we live and walk in your world of great beauty. We pray for those troubled places of the earth where violence reigned and where people suffer from needless assaults. Swing low over all violence and temper all hearts of hate. Finally, we pray for all that may be mourning this day, that somehow in the midst of their pain, they might experience your peace, your love, and even your grace. Now we pray the prayer our Lord taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread as we forgive our trespasses. And as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
We have indeed been so blessed by music today, the strings, the choir, and singing of these hymns. My heart is soaring, and I pray that yours is as well. By the grace of God, may your heart be kindled to live in humble service, in faith, serve with tireless striving to share God's abundant life. God's amazing grace be upon you each day. And now hear this benediction from Ephesians. Peace be to the whole community and love with faith from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace be with all who have an undying love for our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Have a beautiful week, everyone.